We missed the industrial and semiconductor revolutions, but the 80s marked our telecommunications triumph. As AI scripts new narratives, where is India's position? And what about the much awaiting revolution in technology by nano? What's India's story? Welcome to Asianet News Science Talk and get ready to explore India's story in the next revolution in technology by nanomaterials and devices. With two distinguished scientists who have not only witnessed but also shaped this journey. Let's welcome Professor Pulikkal Ajayan, a global authority in nanoscience and nanotechnology, and Professor Shaiju Mohan, a driving force in solid-state battery innovation. Professor P.M. Ajayan is the founding chair of the Material Science and Nano Engineering Department at Rice University in USA. And Professor Shaiju Mohan is the faculty at School of Physics in ICER, Thiruvananthapuram. Let's begin by asking your response on our Chandrayaan 3 success. India's lunar mission, lighting up the dark side of the moon. What is its impact on the future space exploration and basic science material research?
So I happened to be at Indian Institute of Science the last few days, and of course it coincided with the day Chandrayaan landed on moon, and we in fact watched this on a big screen at ISE, and I could see the excitement of people and the anticipation, and I have to say that it was really a moment to reckon, because not only that it is a milestone that India has managed to jump, but it's also a collective concerted effort of so many scientists and so many, you know, technologists over many, many, many years. I mean, it proves to the world that indigenously, India is capable of accomplishing a task like that. But more than that, it kind of tells you that you could have long-term sustained effort in a sector that will ultimately bear fruit. And I think, you know, hopefully in the future, you will see many other sectors in India that does similar thing. Really, long-term investment is important. Of course, now coming to impact, obviously nobody else has landed in the South Pole of Moon, and that's the first for anyone. So that's an exciting thing. And I think all over the world, people are looking at what Chandrayaan can produce in terms of information. Even if it's a short duration of 2 weeks, you could have many fundamental new information that could lead to outstanding science and research in the future. You know, again, materials, as you said, features pretty prominently in this. Now, we don't know what the mineral composition is. We don't know how the radiation effects are going to be. So
it's read that the moon has stopped evolution after 2 billion years. So how much important is the study of the materials there? How pristine is the environment there?
I think it's very, very important. I'm sure that, you know, there has been analysis of, you know, material from moon, from other parts, but the South Pole is kind of the hidden side of moon, so no one really knows. And I think the information that we are going to get will be something that a lot of scientific community is going to look forward to.
How much importance it's for nanoscience?
Well, for nanoscience, I don't know. I mean, again, I'm sure this is going to be bulk materials, and but I think another aspect of this is that if we are planning to colonize the moon and other planets, we need to understand, what kind of materials could survive. And in addition to that, what kind of resources we have in the moon or any other planet, so that we can utilize that to build our base there.
Will moon be a takeoff point for further planetary exploration?
It has always been the case, right? I mean, when the first landing of people on moon, that was again a big moment, and I think that led to many other explorations. And with such precise ability for us to kind of control and land and experiment on Moon, I think this is going to lead to many, many other explorations on other planets. Moon.
This Pragyan rover has a lifespan of only one lunar day or 14 Earth days. So in nanotechnology, can we, do you see any future of this energy storage devices surviving in this extreme dark and cold environment?
There is a lot of studies on expanding the life, you know, performance of batteries and other energy storage devices. I think Shaiju is a better person because he was specifically on batteries.
No, but I think, you know, there's I think devoted work going on in Professor Ajan's group also, which he has started, mostly on high temperature batteries, right? And their batteries that can go.
But here the temperature is very low.
I'm telling you, it can go to any harsh conditions as well. Right?
I think that window of operation has been very limited for whatever we use.
Yeah.
I mean, both low temperature and high temperatures are important, right?
Professor Ajan, we would like to hear your exciting story from Kodungallur to become the top scientist in the world.
I always say that Kodungallur is the center of the universe. You know, actually, it is certainly the center of the old, you know, historic India, because it was a big port and all that. People actually tease me because I'm always, you know, talking about Kodungallur. But, you know, I grew up in a middle-class family, maybe a lower middle-class family.
Your parents?
My father was in telephones and mother was a high school teacher. And
you studied in Malayalam medium school?
I studied till 7th grade in my local Malayalam medium school, and then I came to Trivandrum because I got a scholarship to come to Loyola School here.
How is the education at Loyola?
Loyola to me was really a turning point, because I would say it was almost a step function in terms of not just getting information and understanding basics, but what you can do and what potential is there for you to explore. It really opened up my mind, because the teachers were very good, and they all knew about the world, you know, much bigger picture of the world compared to the teachers in Kodungallur. I'm not saying that they were not good in their subject matter, but the profile that allows you to tell students that anything is possible was obviously there.
That's a great motivation. Anything is possible.
That is a great motivation, absolutely. Right? I think that's what we should be telling our young people. Whatever they do, they can achieve. And, you know, the situation in India has changed over time. Now, it's not just about this whole potential, but also reality. You know, facilities have gotten better. Information has always gotten better. I mean, I'm sure that Shaiju is in a similar situation. He came from a small place, right?
Yeah.
From Kannur.
Yeah.
How is the journey?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think more or less very similar, because I also come from a very small place called Nadu.
You also studied in Malayalam.
I studied Malayalam till my 5th grade, and then I moved to Trivandrum again.
Which school?
That's interesting. Well, I did my schooling in Sainik School, Karakudam.
Sainik School, Karakudam.
Yeah, so from 6th to 12th, I was in Sainik School, Karakudam.
What motivated you take your career in engineering, and that too in metallurgical engineering from Banaras Hindu University?
Again, I think it is, you know, it was the reality that existed at that point. You know, lower and middle class families those days essentially pushed their children to become either doctors or engineers. I certainly was not interested in medicine, so this was my really only option. Just like many people those days, we wrote exams, competitive exams. I went to write the IIT entrance exam and got through. And, you know, my IIT rank was not good enough to get into the best IITs. But then I realized that if I were to go to a lower ranked, you know, among the IIT rank holders, then I would go to a place and take a topic that is really very good at that place. So metallurgy in Banaras was perhaps the best in India at that point of time.
So you had an interest in metallurgy?
BHU metallurgy at that point was number one in India, with really stalwarts, you know, people who were the best in their field. And when you have education in that kind of environment, you get motivated. Outstanding teachers and professors, and that really changed my...
And you went to US for PhD, and the topic is material science and engineering from Northwestern University. And your thesis was structural transformations in very small particles of gold.
So
is it micro or nano?
Yeah, so it was certainly nano.
But you missed the term nano.
Yeah, so that's another
Why?
Thing, right? You know, sometimes names follow, you know, technology or science. My topic was not really to look at these functionalities, but the structure. Because people were not very clear what is the structure of gold when the particle size is very small. I mean, of course, we know that bulk gold has a face-centered cubic structure, FCC, a cubic lattice. But when you have very small particles, they can organize themselves in even non-crystallographic structures. You can even see things like five-fold symmetry in small particles. So there were a lot of people fascinated by this idea that the structure could be very different at small scale. And at the same time, things like electron microscopy became much better, so you can resolve the structure very clearly.
At that time, electron microscopy was not there.
It was emerging.
High resolution electroscopes.
So my professor in Northwestern, his name was Laurie Marks. He came from Cavendish in Cambridge. He was one of the pioneers in really imaging these small particles, trying to understand the structure. So I worked under him. I was his first student. And he developed the microscopy technique at Northwestern, and we looked at many things, but my thesis was focused on the small particles. And again, we didn't call it nano because the term had not really gained importance at that point.
You are considered as a pioneer in the field of carbon nanotubes. So we would like to hear the story of that.
Sure. Again, there are normally many people who can be called pioneers in any field, right? So I think it was my luck that I ended up at NEC Corporation in Japan after my PhD so that I can do a postdoctoral fellowship.
So you went to Japan for postdoctoral?
Yes.
At NEC.
I joined NEC Corporation. It was a company. And those days, Japanese companies were trying to emulate something similar to the Bell Labs. You know, in the US, Bell Labs had a big name because the people there had complete freedom to do what they wanted. Basic science, you know, really go deeper into understanding of materials. And in 1990, I went to Japan, joined NEC under Sumio Ijima. And that was the time when this nano materials were holding space and holding, you know, firm. So there was a discovery of C60. And in fact, that happened at Rice University in late 80s. And people, you know, after the fullerenes were discovered, the C60 was discovered, there was a big rush to see if there are any other carbon-based nanostructures that could be of interest. And Ijima accidentally found that there were these needle-like structures when they did an arc discharge between two electrodes of carbon. And that was at NEC, and that happened just when
you were in his team?
Yes, I just joined. So I joined in 90, and the first paper by Ijima came in 1991. And I was involved in almost all the subsequent papers.
I saw
papers.
Your name in the smallest carbon.
Right, that was the second paper.
Published
probably,
in
right.
Nature.
Right. So there were lots of Nature papers those days. You know, it was the beginning of a field.
That one of the highly cited papers as well,
Yeah.
What's the science of this incredible strength of these carbon nanotubes when compared to other allotropes of carbon? We know the common carbon, amorphous carbon, then the crystal structure, graphite, it's soft. But when come to diamond, it's harder. And then the most hard materials, graphene, then carbon nanotubes.
So carbon is very special because it can hybridize in different configurations. You know, electronic structure can be quite different. And because the hybridization is different, the bonding can be quite different. And that's why it comes out as graphite, which is this layered structure, and diamond, which is a three-dimensional bonding. Right?
Graphite is very soft and diamond is very hard.
Yeah, because all the bonds are connected in diamond, you know, in a three-dimensional network. So it is essentially isotropically strong. Whereas in the case of graphite, you have these sheets where the bonding in plane is very strong, but they are stuck together as a stack of paper. Right? So paper is strong in plane, but it's very weak off plane. You can easily...
Graphene is two-dimensional.
Yeah, so it's analogy.
But it is stronger than diamond. Is it stronger?
Not really. I mean, it's how you look at it, right? If I look at the in-plane strength of graphene, that could come out as higher than what you find in diamond. But it's not a strong material in three dimensions, right?
But so when you roll it as a carbon nanotube, when it assumes the cylindrical shape?
So nanotubes was quite interesting because there were these very perfect needles made of these sheets that are rolled up, as you said, right? And when you do that, the intrinsic properties essentially reflect the intrinsic properties of the bond itself, right? Because there are not many imperfections, it's perfectly rolled up. And that's why, you know, the carbon-carbon bond is very strong. So if you can create a structure with this carbon-carbon bond in a way that you don't compromise, you know, in terms of, your tensile properties or other mechanical properties, then you can get a very strong material. So it was a construction, the geometry of nanotubes that made all the difference.
How you created this smallest?
Well, it's self-assembled. I mean, we don't really take graphene and roll it up because it's too small, right? But the biggest understanding or the biggest message the discovery of nanotube gave was that you can take a material and bring it to a nanoscale, very small scale, and make small structural perturbations, maybe twist or chirality or strain. You can completely change the properties of the material. I mean, you can go from metallic to semiconducting. Same material, but the scale is small, and you add another...
So at nanoscale, it will be in the quantum state.
Because, you know, we talked about gold already. Similarly, you know, when particle size became small, it became different color. Similarly, when carbon structures are built into the small, tiny needles or cylinders, you can change the electronic properties significantly. So this understanding of the structure...
It will conduct electricity like a superconductor? Or?
It is not a superconductor, but you can have quantum conductor. You know, there is a minimum resistance if you have certain types of structures, but it's very small. So you can make extremely good conductors from nanotubes. Whereas if I look at graphite, which is the parent material of nanotube, there are lots of defects. There are different types of bonding.
So it's a good conductor as well as its strength is very high.
Yeah. It is strong, highly conducting. Maybe, Shaiju, you have some additions, maybe, you know.
I mean, when it comes to even everything, thermal properties, and, you know, one could use it for other applications because you can functionalize these materials, you know, you can play around with the chemistry part as well, so that it fits properly into the, you know, various applications that you're looking at, right?
Professor Shaiju Mohan, your association with Professor Ajayan's lab at US.
I did my bachelor's in physics in Sir Syed College, Thalipuramba, in Kannur. And then I did my master's in St. Thomas College, Thrissur. And after that, I moved to IIT Chennai for my PhD. And I also happened to work on carbon nanotubes. Professor Ajayan was like, you know, God figures at that time. You know, we've been looking through, reading all his papers during my PhD. And then I had an opportunity to, you know, go to Germany to attend a conference, international conference, that was on functional materials in Karlsruhe. And, you know, I knew that, you know, his name was there, one of the speakers. And then, you know, we had some figures in mind, right? And so I just walked in, and then on the very first day itself, you know, I think on the table, tea table, he just came and sat next to us. So, you know, for us, it was like a great moment, right? Somebody who, you know, you're looking at big thing. And, you know, I think, yeah, it's exactly in September 2003. And that was just 3 years, you know, I had another 2 years to go for my PhD. I met him, and then 2 days, 3 days, we were together. There were a couple of other guys from India as well. So, you know, almost end of that, my stay, he just asked me, so he knew that I was also working on, we discussed, and then he said, I mean, why don't you just come over to US and join the group? So that was like, wow. So, you know, the moment I just called up my advisor in, you know, in India, and said, look, I got an offer. So that was exciting. And then it took another 2 years for me to complete my PhD. I was in touch with him.
Went to US.
And then I went to US, and it was in Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, RPI, and that's where he was initially.
Professor Shaijumon, your association with Professor Ajayan's lab was very remarkable, and you both together invented the paper battery. What's the significance of that, and what are the applications in industry and for strategic purposes?
Before that, I want to mention something. You know, Shaiju said that he came over to my lab, and then Shaiju actually started the energy storage work in our group. So it kind of tells you how this whole process happens, right? I mean, a professor might be knowledgeable in certain things, but as new students...
But the curiosity differs.
New postdocs and senior people come to the group, you know, they bring their own ideas and their own experience. And this is how the community works. And
more to it, I think this is something that I also tell my students, because, you know, one of the greatest thing that, you know, looking at Professor Ajayan's group is over the years, and you know, you can ask any of the new students as well, I mean, the kind of freedom that he basically...
No hierarchy there.
Absolutely, there's no hierarchy at all. Yeah. I mean, everyone calls him by his name, so... Yeah. Not just that, but again, I mean, the freedom that is being given to the students and postdocs. So, you know, when I just came from an energy background, and that was a lab where, you know, you can think of any materials, I mean, nanomaterials, carbon nanotubes of different morphology, different size, everything, right? So I came from a completely energy background, and he said, like, look, let's start working on batteries, right? And
that's a great encouragement.
Absolutely, absolutely, right?
But that was not my expertise, but...
Yeah, but then he wanted me to work on batteries, and then we started from scratch, basically. We didn't have a proper glove box that, which is required, you know, because lithium batteries would work on. It needs those atmosphere and things like that. But we sort of, from scratch, we built. But interesting thing is, like, you know, even he said he didn't have the background, but the ideas that has been given, you know, at various stages of these projects was amazing, because, you know, we get to meet, and I still remember, Ajayan, because, you know, we were sitting in the same office. There were a chemist, a colleague of mine, who actually make this carbon nanotube. There's another person who actually make the composite of this nanotube. And I was the person who was supposed to work on batteries. So we were actually stuck at a particular point. I mean, so he was very excited to make these kind of flexible batteries. So this is the one project that he gave me initially when I joined.
It was a very creative idea. You know, today there are lots of industry, including Samsung, who are talking about these flexible batteries and so on. You know, we imagined this almost 20 years ago.
Absolutely, right? Absolutely.
Now it gains popularity for the flexible.
See, not only from the industry point, at that time, I think from the scientific point of view, academic point of view, I think this was one of the first papers.
Yeah, I believe that academic research should be really creativity and thinking out of the box, right? I think that's where the academicians are really good at. You know, we understand, we teach basic science, and I think there is a clear connection between the kind of things we do research-wise and the knowledge that we try to impart. So basic science is extremely important, and that's why we can imagine things.
And your journey spans across the continents, including Japan, Europe, US. How these environments shape your different environments, shape your research and career?
I feel very fortunate that I have been able to stay in different countries doing research and move around. And every place has its own positives and negatives. And if you are able to absorb most of the positives, then you can really shape your career in a very nice way. I think the ability to be creative, liberal, think out of the box, In my case, I think it is a reflection of the various places I have been, the various thought processes that people have people follow in different countries. And the assimilation of that is really wonderful.
What are the merits you saw in Japan?
So the Japanese are very focused, very precise, and very good with their hands, of course. I mean, the Japanese are different from Europeans. Europeans are different from Americans and different from Indians. But the great
Europeans.
Well, again, I think Europeans have a deep appreciation for long-term, sustained basic research. I think it's still Europe is one of those bastions where there is a lot of investment in doing long-term research. I'm very impressed whenever I go to Europe because they have built facilities and they are not really looking at short-term. They are really looking at long-term research. And I think that is that's a merit of... I mean, the U.S. probably it's a mix of European and Asian, flavors, because there's a lot of resources for basic research, but there's also a push for, applied research.
The startup environment is very good at U.S.
Startup environment is extremely good in the U.S., specifically in some geographic locations, like the Bay Area, for example, or Boston. I think that those places, the universities have really created ecosystems where your ideas can be seamlessly translated into something. Not all, of course, startups become successful, but the environment, the ecosystem is there where everybody thinks about building something after a great idea, right? And the universities support that kind of approach.
And your time at Rensselaer in Polytechnic Institute brought up this innovations like smallest brush and the darkest material. Can you explain
so, I mean,
those moments?
Again.
And these are Guinness records also.
For a scientist, Guinness Book of World Record is just another publication maybe, or another report. But I think what we were fascinated those days were the multitude of things that a material like carbon nanotube can accomplish, right? So we were trying all kinds of things. We were making aligned structures, we were making devices, we were making membranes, and the outcome was that we were able to demonstrate some very curious aspects of this assembly of nanostructures. In both cases, the brush that you mentioned and the highly absorbing darkest material, it all came from our ability to assemble nanotubes in a particular direction, a carpet-like nanostructure. So we were not really focused on getting a Guinness Book of World Record, but that came as part of this whole process of figuring out how you can take millions of nanostructures, assemble in certain forms, create these, larger scale architectures. Because, I think we started off by saying that nano is still very small. You can't really pick and place. That will not be an efficient method. So we have to devise ways of assembling them so that large numbers of them come together in certain form. And once that happens, once there is order, once there is periodicity, once you're able to assemble a large number of these nanomaterials, then there will be exciting emergent properties like huge absorption of light, or a perfect membrane, or a beautiful aligned nanotube device, electronic device. So, there is the aspect of creating nanomaterials, understanding them, that happened, maybe 20, 30 years ago, and even still, but the main effort was done many years ago. And then there was a period when they were assembling structures, understanding how they connect, how they build together. And then the next phase is integration, how they get integrated into devices, integrated into applications. So it's a long process, and we have learned a lot in the process.
Is there any applications they hold in industry? And
well, in different ways. I mean, nano brush, the way we imagined those days, was not probably the application that happened. But these compliant brush-like nanotube structures have been used, for example, in medical implants, you know, because the elasticity of these is very interesting. People are now thinking of lining helmets with these so that, you know, you can get a better response to concussion and things like that, right, if there is an accident. So I think, you know, many times when you think about an idea, it may not be the final product because many iterations it get bifurcated, and in the end, the basic idea might be there, but it ends up as a different type of product than you imagine. Right?
And the darkest material?
I think it's the same story. I mean, there were a lot of work subsequently that looked at, you know, thermophoto electrics, conversion of, you know, light into, because absorbers are important for many applications.
Later you moved to Rice University and Professor Shai Jumon also accompanied you. But in 2010, you returned to India. And why you shifted from RIP to Rice and you returned to India?
Rice was also well known for its carbon research. You know, Smalley and Curl had won the Nobel Prize in C60. So there was already an existing carbon science infrastructure. So it was a perfect move for me in that sense. But that time, again, Shaiji moved with us, that was a time when the nanotube to graphene transition was happening. You know, graphene had been just discovered and people were starting to look at this different dimensionality. You know, nanostructure still, but more two-dimensional than one-dimensional. And we also got into the game and we did a lot of very creative, nice initial work, not in graphene particularly, but some of the two-dimensional materials that followed graphene, you know, like boron nitride, which is an insulator, transition metal dichalcogenides, which are semiconductors.
So what are the 2D materials?
You can have metallic or semiconducting. A metallic 2D material would be graphene. A semiconductor 2D material would be these transition metal dichalcogenides, like molybdenum sulfide and so on. An insulating 2D material would be boron nitride. So these are all atomically thin or a single unit, lattice unit thick materials, which you can grow over very large area and very good quality. So there is a strong potential that some of these materials will enter the semiconductor, you know, future semiconductor technologies. So that's why there's a strong interest, sensors maybe, you know, flexible electronics. So there's a lot of activity in these areas.
So from such an exciting atmosphere, you returned to India.
I was kind of determined to come back to India from day one I landed, and because, you know, all my other colleagues, you know, were getting ready with their green card and all. But I sort of wanted to come back from day one. So my preparation was all there. Yeah. So I stayed, you know, again, I moved from RPI with Prasajan. But Rice, I stayed for another close to one and a half years. And then 2009, I planned to come back, and then I just took a break there. For one and a half years, I was in Toulouse in France, you know, working with another group, Professor Patrice Simon. He was more working on supercapacitors and, you know, those energy storage devices.
That's also enhancing the energy.
Absolutely. This is an energy area as well, and, you know, he was also a known person in that area. So, yeah, I just, on the way back to India,
So, from PhD onwards, you concentrated on this area?
My area was more focused on energy, yes. Yeah. Because, in fact, it is interesting because I did my PhD mostly on fuel cells, right? Hydrogen storage fuel cells. And, you know, started the batteries when I came to Prasajan's group. And then did some work on 3D micro batteries, which is, again, an exciting area, which we had initiated some work when I was in Prasajan's group. And we had a very interesting paper. While we were in Agents Group. You're really talking about making a battery on a nanowire, right? People say, you know, batteries made of nanowire. I would say that was something like a battery is made on a nanowire. Think about it, right?
It's similar to a semiconductor device.
Exactly. You know,
a semiconductor device, a semiconductor, metal, insulator, all put together, you have a device, but at the nanoscale. And we demonstrated that it is feasible to put all the components of a battery on a small space, like a nano battery.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So in the chip itself, you can place it.
I think the end application would be something like an on-chip power, you know, application, on-chip energy storage, something like that.
From 2014 onwards, you are the founding chair of the material science and nano engineering. How you strike the balance between this material science, that is basic science and engineering?
We were part of mechanical engineering before at Rice. You know, it was materials as a program in mechanical engineering. And then when we decided to create this new department, we realized that most of the material scientists today work at the nanoscale, you know, research-wise. It is, the future is about creating materials by nanoscale building blocks, right? Because you have flexibility, you can have hierarchical architecture building. So it was very obvious that that would be the right combination of terms in a department. You know, you have people, nano engineering leading to materials, and that's where the next future of material science is.
Need the science and engineering to build materials.
Absolutely.
Professor Shaiju, your expertise in energy storage devices now is with solid state battery devices. Then how does your experience with the paper battery now help you to accomplish this mission?
You know, I think it all started, my journey in batteries, it all started from, you know, Professor Ajayan's group, you know, playing around with materials at the time. In all our batteries, we have liquid electrolytes, right? So this has potential risk. So now, two factors are there. One is we want to increase the energy density from the existing one so that it can cater to the vehicular applications. Number two is we have to take care of the safety aspects. And these two could be very well addressed if I replace the liquid component of a battery with completely solid, which means like I have an anode, a cathode, and an electrolyte which is liquid. I'm going to replace the liquid electrolyte with a solid electrolyte. Then I have no problem. Energy density can go high. There is no safety issues because there is no liquid in it. And that's the excitement with which the whole world is moving towards. I think solid state batteries are going to be the future of battery technology for sure. Right?
I mean, it's a challenging proposition because in order to get higher energy density, you need higher diffusion of ions, and right, that's where your
body absolutely. I think that's the point, because now you think about it, I have three solid pieces, anode, cathode, and there is one. There was liquid, then this ionic transport, as Professor Ajayan was mentioning, it was so easy. Now you see, from a solid to solid to solid, the ion will have to jump. There is an interface problem, right? So engineering that interface is probably one of the biggest challenges in solid state batteries, right? What materials could go on? I mean, you don't have to really go behind new materials in terms of the battery components, but then how do you engineer this, right?
I mean, a battery system is a perfect example of, you know, basic research in materials and interfaces lead to a real practical solution. I think it's a real fascinating problem.
Absolutely.
And the interesting thing is that you moved from smaller storage devices to big.
No, I think it was interesting. Your question was like, what did I learn from the paper battery? I mean, I think it's very interesting. He answered that question earlier, because at that time, probably it was too early, the technology of something like that. Because if I look back, what we were trying to attempt there also was more or less similar, to make it some sort of a, let's say, you know, a quasi solid state or, something like that. We were actually, but without knowing it's a solid state battery, we were actually working. We were trying to reduce the electrolyte, liquid electrolyte.
It was more of a gel.
It was more of a gel, exactly, right? It was more of a gel. We called it like a, you know, solid state battery or something like that.
Yeah. Again, you know, people were not really looking at solid state batteries those days.
Those days, exactly.
Maybe some ideas were there, but
right,
still.
Right, right. So now when I come back and start working on it, you know, I could really relate to it, you know, what's going on, right? And there's a huge initiative now, globally.
And I heard that Thiruvananthapuram ICER holds an important position in the National Initiative for Solid-State Battery Research.
Yeah, that's true. So, you know, what happens, like lithium-ion batteries as such has been going on. A lot of projects were there. But now, you know, Government of India has decided to, you know, take an initiative on solid-state battery technology development. And the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, has came up with this unique initiative where, you know, they've sort of formed a consortium, right, just focused on the accelerated development of solid-state battery technology in the country. And that consortium contains around 14 institutions all across India, various IITs and CSIR labs. And I'm actually heading the institution. I'm the center head here, and the institution and then the center is at placed in ICER.
So we are leading with, our national initiative.
Yeah, we have two leads basically, along with another a friend of mine who is Professor Yogesh Sharma from IIT Roorkee, and but the center is in Trivandrum and heading the center. So I think it's a huge initiative because very well what pointed out Professor Rajan, because this is a technology where various people are coming together. If you ask me who are these 14 partners, there are AI, artificial intelligence, machine learning people who really look into these things, screen out the materials. There are automation people, right? Because we want to really accelerate the technology. Can we automate some of these techniques, right? Rather than manually doing. And there are theoreticians, there are chemists, there are physicists like me, there are material scientists. So ideas, everybody come together, put their own effort and, trying to build something.
I mean, I think there are two options, right? One is you generate idea in an academic environment and somebody comes and picks it up, maybe entrepreneurial people, and then quickly develop this into higher tier levels. But I think that has kind of changed recently, that the academic institutions themselves are doing slightly higher tier levels by this bringing together of people with different expertise.
Absolutely.
It's an interesting model.
Absolutely, right? Absolutely. Multi-institutional kind of thing.
Yeah. And our government hopes that by 2025, building this electric vehicles here itself, and they invited Tesla also here. So by 2025, we can have electric vehicles at the same cost of petrol or diesel vehicles. And by 2030, they aim a complete transformation to electric vehicles to save our planet from greenhouse gases.
I think it's easier, easier said than done, right? I mean, even in countries like the US, although we have big hopes, I think that level of transformation is very difficult to achieve. Particularly because it's not even the cost. I mean, cost is a different issue. The infrastructure needed for charging and things like that has to be completely revamped. And, perhaps there are certain sectors that can be easier
again,
implemented.
We need to depend for the fossil fuels for generating so much
electricity.
Yeah,
so that's the other thing, right? I mean, overall, is it green or is it blue or
we cannot be
color,
sure,
right?
Whether we can get all this energy from solar cells.
Ultimately
that is the aim, depend completely on renewable resources.
Yeah. So I mean, I think we are competing with different technologies for sustainability and renewables.
This is the blueprint for our national mission for solid state battery research.
No, see, asking that question, see, again, I mean, this EV battery, I mean, by EV30, that is the Government of India policy, which came up in 2017, if I'm right. But what it means is like 30% of, we move 30% of the vehicles into electric vehicles. But then, as he was pointing out, because infrastructure also has to be developed, right? It's not just the battery. What happens if I develop a battery and give the vehicle, but then what about the charging stations?
Yeah.
I think this is very
also
important.
Also, the cost of battery after its lifespan, the cost of battery is very much to replace it.
Yeah, and the whole life cycle has to be analyzed, right? I mean,
and also the environmental impact of disposal of these batteries.
Yeah, we were just discussing. For example, now there's a lot of this two-wheeler, three-wheeler electric powered vehicles are there, right? Everything goes fine now, but then, down the line in another, let's say, 3 to 4 years, what is going to happen, nobody knows. Because, once this all start dumping, it's more of a problem. How are we going to manage it?
Yeah.
So, is there a solution to recycle these batteries?
There is recycling possibilities. I mean, we have some work going on in our lab on recycling. And I mean, as we discussed, there are many pain points, right? I mean, of course, cost is one, infrastructure is another one. Then, after the lifetime of batteries, what do we do with them? There are lots of questions which are not really addressed at this point.
That's really.
So what are the advantages of these solid-state batteries over lithium-ion batteries?
So that's exactly, you know, one is of course the energy density that we get, because the amount of charge that could be stored in the battery.
So we can get greater mileage.
Absolutely. You can get greater mileage, and we can use it for
more safety.
More safe, completely safe. There is no issue then. There is no big issue. I think these two, if you could address it, you know, these are very interesting.
But what's the future of lithium-ion battery globally? Tesla also invested in lithium-ion battery.
So that's the other big question. You know, there is critical materials issues, right? I mean, many of the batteries that exist today use very rare materials like cobalt and and nickel, which many countries don't have.
I think more than lithium, cobalt is a killer as well, right?
Yeah, I mean, and there are again
critical elements.
The government report says that the world has more than enough lithium deposits, but you say that cobalt and nickel.
Cobalt is also very rare.
Even lithium, extractable lithium, you know, cheap lithium, you know, is not enough. I think if the supply goes as we predicted.
So there is news that will we go to sodium battery?
Yeah, I think there is a lot of interest going on, at least at the academic level. I mean, even
when we both our groups work on sodium.
Yeah, both of us are, right? Our groups are working.
And there's already some demonstrations at the commercial level for sodium ion.
What are the merits of this sodium battery?
I think the merit is that you know, it's safer. For example, sodium is less reactive.
Abundance. And especially countries like India and all, you can you know, invest a lot. But there's a small compromise when it comes to the capacity, because it's slightly lower in voltage. That is going to reflect in the performance level.
And there is news that lithium deposits found in Jammu and Kashmir. Can we have enough technology to excavate?
You know, at least the whole battery community in India and others were so excited when we heard this news, right? But when you really go back and look at it, I mean, it's certainly point to, you know, get excited, but then at the same time, as you were saying, you know, the amount of energy that we need to, you know, put in to extract this lithium, you know, mining and then refining is also another big issue. So, and nobody knows how many years we are going to wait to start extracting lithium from our resources that we just
found. By the time the sodium ion batteries will
maybe might pick it up, absolutely.
Professor Ajay Envy, with your extensive research portfolio, that is 33 US patents, more in waiting, and more than 1,000 journal papers. And how do you perceive?
You missed one thing. There's something called H index.
H index,
Probably, well, I mean, nobody can touch
you
on
150 and 95,000 citations.
H index is more than that, close to 200, I would say. I didn't check it, but
what is H index in?
Well, so H index is kind of a metric used to see how prolific you are, productive you are, right? These are all metrics, right, that we use, statistics that we use, but that's not everything. I think we should look at contributions in terms of impact, right? I mean, basic science as well as, you know, real products. I think I've been lucky to get a good team all the time working on various aspects of materials, and that is why our group could be so broad and prolific.
And you are in the editorial boards of many research journals.
Yeah, I mean, as you get...
So how do you perceive the challenges Indian scientists facing to publish their papers in Nature-like
journals? That's a very good question.
And securing patents.
Yeah. I mean, the situation is changing, but I understand that question. I think there is always an inherent bias when you are not a proven entity, right? This has happened with China as well.
China overtook US this year.
Yeah, but they were struggling. 20 years ago, they had the same issues. They were struggling to publish in good journals. They were struggling to get... but, you know, they did a conscious investment in science and technology, and the facilities got better. You know, good people returned to China. So I think they improved in all the metrics that you mentioned. I think in India is changing for sure. I mean, there are institutions in India right now publishing in good journals and doing very well. But that's not across the board, because I think the resources that has been put in place for basic science.
What are the changes we record here?
So I think there has to be an order of magnitude higher investment. in basic science and applied sciences, right? I think we still are probably, if I remember right, less than 1% of GDP.
Also, Professor Ajayan, you are visiting professors in many higher institutes here, IISc and IITs. How do you see the industry-academia relation in India when compared to US?
I mean, there were very many different aspects of this problem, the industry-academia connection.
Regarding the funding also. In US, the funding is more from private industries.
No. In academia, I think our funding is probably mostly from federal agencies, but a significant amount comes from industry as well.
But when compared to India?
Yeah, so I think India, it's getting much, much better because of many of the policies in place now. So it is not just about collaborations with faculty, but also the opportunities for students. I think that's another aspect that is very important in this relationship.
So it will help to build the startup culture around all this.
Startup culture, internships, exposure, right? I mean,
for students. Perspectives, right? Yeah. I look at that way.
So how much we need to improve for the industries to hire students from basic science courses? Usually industries
it's a supply and demand problem,
from
right?
Technology areas.
Yeah, but it's a supply and demand. I mean, you know, for example, we have in the US and many other countries a severe workforce problem, right? You cannot find enough people to work in certain key sectors. And I'm sure that issue will come here as well, right? I mean, it's the end of the day, it's a supply and demand, right?
How is it ICER?
ICERs are generally more focused on fundamental science, okay? Probably people like me are a bit off from that. And I do a lot of, industry projects in ICER. So compared to the other institutes like IITs and all, only very few industries approach us. But, you know, since, we are...
Usually industries approach first IIT.
Absolutely. Yeah. Because that's what they want, right? Mm-hmm. But, you know, since we are now into the field, probably they also start coming.
Maybe it's also a question of projection. Right?
Exactly. How is the funding from...
No, funding is there. Funding is certainly there. And one of the things is like, see, more than funding, I think there was some gap was there, industry, academia. Hmm. Some trust fact, something was there. But that is lessening now. And there's a lot of forums now, you know, I'm part of various meetings that has happened over last five. I think it was very nice that he's... The last 5 years, we really got to see conclaves, industry, academia conclaves on hydrogen, energy storage. Several things has happened. So that gap is, reduced now, and industries have started coming forward, funding in key areas as well, right?
Also, industry realizes that they could get a lot done at much lower cost if they can collaborate with academia. Of course, there are issues with IP and other things, which there should be a national policy, and maybe there is one I'm not aware of. Even in the US, we struggle with how you work with industry when it comes to the IP issues.
How much is the funding you get from private?
We do get reasonably good funding because it's mostly for a shorter period, for a one-year program.
Yeah, that's the problem.
That's the other problem. But, you know, if you really project it, like, it is equivalent to what we get from, the funding federal agencies as well.
But the state institutes, like university centers, will they get enough funding from
the industries? Maybe not. See, again, as you were saying, the projection is important, and they also should feel for it, right? They fund you, and I mean, it is not like the other government funding, because I run like 3 or 4 industry projects, and then it is not that easy as well.
So that's an issue. Many the political leaders invite many scientists to come back and take charge of the universities here. The main issue is funding. So, in what areas they should improve to get more funding?
You know, facilities is obviously one of them, because if industry comes to university, they are looking for some deliverables, very clear. And without facilities, you can't do that, right? But there may be projects where you don't need such big infrastructure.
You can start from there and then start building.
Yeah, so I think there has to be also some hand-holding, you know, from the government side or from some other sides, where you can connect these state universities to industry for specific expertise. So it's an ecosystem. As it develops, lots of things will change. I mean, even places like IISc, you know, things have improved dramatically in the last 5 to 10 years, right? And maybe it'll take another decade for smaller universities to get into the same shoes. But I also think that the local governments and the state should also be a player. They should also be a constituency in this ecosystem. You know, many places in Europe and US, the states actually put in a lot of resources because they want to develop a particular region, there's a specific interest. I don't see in India at the moment, right?
Yeah, maybe it's slowly coming up slowly because, coming up, you know, in Kerala, there's a lot of these initiatives on EV, electric mobility.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
That's another initiative area.
Is the Kerala government's e-mobility and the Graphene Park coming in Kalamashiri. And you have an important role.
These are like, you know, great initiatives from government of Kerala because one is on EV. I mean, Kerala government has an EV policy which came up in 2019. And you know, then there is a EV consortium has been set up with you know, VSSC, Triumgur Titanium Products Limited, TTPL, and CDAC, right? So these three are the active partners here. I'm not actively participate, but I'm on the advisory board of this. But I do sit in all the meetings and all. I think it's progressing very well. And recently we had this you know, first transfer of this indigenously made lithium ion battery. In Honorable Industries Minister Sri Rajiv actually did that in presence of him.
Your institute made.
No. This was done because it was you know, it was built indigenously by VSSC, and it was handed over to you know, KDISC, who is the you know, central lead in, you know, agency.
There are a lot of local resources that could be developed through these partnerships, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if you look at Kerala, there is a rare earths, titanium. There is you know. And now there's a graphene initiative. So even from a materials perspective, I think if the partnerships between government, academia, and industry work nicely, it will certainly be a very attractive thing.
See, for example, this initiative, what it really means is like around 60% to 70% we get everything locally. The new battery which has been transferred now, it's like 20 ampere hour battery, and it is completely from the titanium. It's actually an LTO. battery. So, you know, the lithium titanate battery, and it is completely developed here, I mean, by the TTPL, right? And as you were saying, there are other minerals, you know, Kerala, we can actually really start looking at our own, you know,
and this should
minerals.
Be showcased so that there is an awareness in industry that this is possible.
Your association with State Higher Education Council's Erudite program, how promising are our students?
So, I just did an Erudite program 2 months ago. And it was very exciting for me to motivate students from smaller colleges. And, you know, there is a lot of talent here. And I think many times they are lost in some sense because they don't know what their future path is. And hearing from senior people who have contributed to science is good for them. I think, you know, that's an excellent program.
And what improvements do you suggest for our colleges and universities here?
You know, it's hard to really suggest many specific things. I mean, you know, it's more, Erudite program is more motivational than anything else. To suggest specific things, you need to have a better understanding of ground reality, which I don't have. So, my, you know, as an Erudite scholar, my intention was to really, you know, get the students motivated so that they at least think about STEM for the future. And they realize the relevance of science and technology on society. I think that is basically the idea.
But there is a recent trend of migrating students to Western countries, especially to Europe, soon after completing their higher education, higher secondary education.
Yeah.
So what's your perspective on what are the risks or involved in it, or what precautions they take while choosing the universities abroad?
I think there are a couple of reasons why this is happening. One is financial independence. Now there are lots of opportunities for them to get loans and other stuff, and they can afford going abroad. And, you know, I don't see any negatives in going abroad because that gives them a different perspective, especially if ultimately they're going to come back to India to contribute. The immediate issue is that the local institutions have a problem.
Now the local institutions suffering, and even the university college itself, many seats are now vacant for basic science.
So that's
courses.
A problem, right? And I think the counter argument would be that this forces them to maybe canvas more for STEM students across the board. I mean, most of these people who are going out are going to do STEM. In fact, it's a good thing because that increases
STEM means
science and technology related
engineering
and math.
So industry related.
Not necessarily industry, but science and technology related professions, right? But immediately there is an issue because you don't have, you know, students to come to these colleges. I think they have a tough challenge ahead of them. You know, they need to
That's a great problem in our higher education sector now.
Yeah, it is a problem.
What's your perspective?
No, but I mean, exactly. I think it all stems from this financial independence. But then, I mean, slightly
what precautions
caution,
they take
yeah.
while
See,
choosing
what,
the universities.
I think what the kids should also be aware of the fact that, you know, they should get into a reasonable good place.
Yeah.
Often what happens is like, you know, people just go abroad.
How they should select universities, what criteria they...
I think that's very important because, you know, you know it's just the fact that you are abroad doesn't mean everything, right? Even for PhD, if you just land up in the, you know, bottom 100 or less than that university, then... Maybe.
So these are things that maybe a coordinated effort can do,
change it,
right?
Yeah.
If many folks from higher education get together and probably create a list of universities where it might be worthwhile going for a degree, that would be a fantastic resource for the students, right?
That's a key, actually. That's a key to really look at it.
Recently, the central government allotted ₹250 crore. To IIT Chennai for synthetic nano diamonds project, and heard that you initiated this project in US many years ago.
So,
what's the scope of this
field? So diamond is an interesting material. I mean, everybody likes diamond, right? For some reason or the other. In technology applications, diamond are used for example, cutting tools. That's been there for a long time. But those diamonds are made by high pressure, high temperature technique. Whereas what the recent thing that we have done, our group and many a few other groups in the US, is the ability to look at diamond as an electronic material. So if you want to use diamond for electronic material, you want to grow thin films of diamond of high quality, like by CVD. You know, diamond again is interesting. The first time people realized diamond is made of carbon was in the 1700s. And then to really make a diamond film by CVD was in 1962. That was the year I was born, actually. So over the years, the quality of diamonds have improved dramatically. And there is an advantage of using materials like diamond for electronics because their band gap is much larger. And with increasing band gap, certain performance metrics for electronic devices get better, especially if you're using it for high power, high frequency. There are many advantages. And one significant advantage of diamond as a device is the thermal conductivity is the best of any material, right? So, and people are now figuring out how to make these devices by doping, by surface modification. There are lots of processes. But the bottom line, in summary, what has happened is synthetic diamond, thin films of synthetic diamond, is becoming a viable option as a potential device material.
Any strategic purpose in it? Because I heard that China is leading in this area.
No, not really. I think the diamond work, I would say the Japanese and the Europeans are really leaders in the field. But this combination of things, realization that the ultra-wide band gap diamond is a very good material for devices, high thermal conductivity, the ability to grow high-quality thin films of diamond. All these have suddenly come together to make it a viable semiconductor material, right? And I don't exactly know...
So is it a future semiconductor material?
It could possibly be. I mean, there are a few options for ultra-wide band gap. So, you know, we started off with silicon and germanium, and then we went to the compound semiconductors like gallium arsenide. Then we went to gallium nitride, which is a wide band gap material. We went to silicon carbide, which is also a wide band gap. And now you are looking at things like diamond, boron nitride, gallium oxide, and a few other materials. So it's a progression of events. And the biggest problem with diamond as a device material was the ability to grow good quality diamond, and that's suddenly happening.
And how long should we wait for the next revolution in technology by nanomaterials?
No, it's just happening, right? So the nanomaterials or nano revolution started to happen in 1980s. So it's taken 30 years. And as I was saying before, the initial phase was more about materials development.
It is the time to see this in our real size technology.
Yeah, it is. Nano is already there, right? I mean, in semiconductor technologies, you are talking about less than 10 nanometer devices. Obviously, it's already in practice. You know, it'll appear in your chips very soon.
So, what's India's position in this?
So, India had many initiatives on nano, not necessarily for the semiconductor technologies, because we never had, you know, big footprint in that area. So, that is something that we missed. That's what you started saying, right? But there are emerging new types of technologies that would complement, you know, the semiconductor, traditional semiconductor.
Now the scope of AI in nanotechnology.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, they are all coming together. And I think Saiju was also mentioning about batteries, right? You need the computational people who do machine learning and stuff like that. You need the materials people, you need the device people, you need the actual implementation and integration folks. So I think this is true for pretty much any discipline today, right?
Yeah.
Your family?
Family is doing well. Now, my wife is also working at Rice. Her name is Poonima.
She's also a scientist.
No, she is an MBA in finance, and she works in the dean's office there. I have two daughters. One of them is doing a PhD. Her name is Anaka. She does a PhD in neuroscience in the University of Southern California. My second daughter, she is doing an undergraduate at Rice.
And she's a singer also.
She's a singer, yeah.
She sang in the film Aisha.
Yeah, so she's trained in Carnatic music, but she recently sang in Aisha and also the Sulaikaman song. Two movie songs she has sung. So hopefully, I think her interest is in music for sure, and she might sing more.
Do you have any interest in music?
I have a lot of interest in music. I'm a very regular listener of Carnatic music. I love Carnatic music. And
he writes?
Writes music?
No, I mean the poem and all that.
I used to write poems. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's all a question about certain phases in your life, right? I mean, I would still like to write at some point, but...
Your family?
Yeah, so my wife, Prafulla, she's from a computer science background, and she's a faculty in Government College of Engineering, Trivandrum. And I have two kids. Elder one is in 8th grade. And
Two daughters.
I have two daughters, yeah.
All scientists have daughters.
So, yeah, my elder one is in 8th grade in here in Kendriya Vidyalaya, Sri Mai. And I have a little one. She's about 3 years now, Nihika.
Thank you. Professor Ajayan and Professor Saiju for finding
time.
It was a pleasure talking to you.
Mm-hmm. Really nice.
Also, we extend our gratitude to your family supporting your busy schedule and research. And we wish you continued success in all your research and coming projects.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.